صلى الله عليك يا سيدي ويا مولاي يا رسول الله صلى الله عليك يا أبا عبد الله يا رحمة الله الواسعة ويا باب نجاة الأمة يا ليتنا كنا معكم سيدي وسعادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما أفاطم لا وخنت الحسين مجدلا وقد مات عطشانا يا 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 بشط فراتي إذا للطمت الخد فاطم عنده وأجريت دمع العين على الوجه ناتي أفاطم قومي يا ابنة الخير واندبي نجوم السماوات بأرضي فلا يا 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 نوحي على الأولاد يا زهر الحزينة في كربلاء واحد واحد في المدينة نعيدها نوحي على الأولاد يا زهر الحزينة في كربلاء واحد واحد في المدينة أبيات تألم قلب الحجة الليلة تقول ولاذت ولاذت ورا الباب اختفت فاطم ولاذا يا 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 خايب يا خايب ولاذا صار هالماي لهم روى ولا ذايا يا 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 انت خايب لا مجاب تنك ولا ذا انت ذنب لجلت والسد المنية يا يا ذنب لجلت والسدها وإنا إليه راجعون لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم قال مولانا ومؤسسي مذهبنا الإمام الصادق سلام الله تعالى عليه وإنما سميت فاطمة لأن الخلق فطموا عن معرفتها
It's perhaps safe to say that there are some individuals that intellects can't grasp. It's difficult to understand them through an intellectual means. Meaning if you study them simply through the mind, you'll do an injustice to them, you'll waste your time, and at the end of the day, you would not get a grasp of who that individual is. For that reason, we decide to love certain individuals. Because we fail to understand them intellectually, love comes in the picture and it fills that gap. It says you can't understand this individual through the intellect and the aql that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. Therefore, encompass them through the heart. And this applies to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala initially, first and foremost. It's impossible to understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the intellectual route. Of course, there are many different ways to be able to prove scientifically the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But for the most part, our sixth Imam, salamu ta'ala alayhi, he comes and he tells us, don't try to understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intellectually, lest you will get lost. Because for a finite creature to understand an infinite entity is something that even mathematically perhaps makes little or no sense. That's why we decide to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why hub of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is something essential within the whole Quran. Allah, how many times has he mentioned the word love? Some say 69 times, others have different explanations. For the most part, we know that love is something mentioned repeatedly within the Holy Quran. And it's something that is seen as a central theme within the Holy Quran. That's why even when you come to the hadith and the ad'iyah, they are replete with the word hub. For goodness sake, they would come to our sixth Imam salamu wa ta'ala alayhi, and they would tell him, ya Imam, is there love in religion? Is love a part of religion? To where the Imam salamu wa ta'ala alayhi would reply, he would say, wa hal al-din illa al-hub. He would say, is religion anything but love? No, love isn't a part of religion. Is religion anything but love? And of course, with every love, there must come hate. Because if you love something, it only makes sense to hate its opposite. That's why it's very interesting when you see people as I mentioned to you yesterday, that love haq and batil, because two opposites fail to coincide within the same heart. That's why when we come to this hadith al-Qudsi, a divine narration of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he comes and he tells us, ma wasi'atni ardi wala sama'i. He says, neither the earth, neither the sky, nor the earth can encompass me, except one thing. وَلَكِنْ وَسِعَنِي قَلْبُ عَبْدِيَ الْمُؤْمِنِ. He says, yet the heart of the believer could encompass me. Hence, when we fail to understand certain individuals intellectually, we resort, as one would say, to the spiritual path, which is the heart. We love certain individuals. That's why someone comes and asks a question, could we understand Fatima Zahra salamu wa ta'ala alayha through the intellectual path, a hadith? Don't you disagree? We come to the narrations and we see that a plethora of narrations tend to tell us that it's impossible to understand Fatima Zahra. Typically, for example, we come to a hadith that explains the greatness of Abu Abdullah al-Husayn salamu wa ta'ala alayhi, and it explains him, for example, as being a ship. It compares him to something. Al-Husayn, Misbah al-Huda, wa Safina al-Najat. It describes him with something tangible. Or when it describes the other a'imma, it says they are a beacon of light. They are nur, something that is picturable. You can think of light. You can see light. It's something tangible. When the narrations come and describe Fatima Zahra salamu wa ta'ala alayha, they make it very clear that if you want to understand her through the intellect, you'll fail, and you're not only going to fail, you'll fail miserably. For example, our sixth Imam comes and tells us the hadith that was initiated. He comes and he says, وَإِنَّمَا سُمِّيَتْ فَاطِمَةً لِأَنَّ الْخَلْقَ فُطِمُوا عَنْ مَعْرِفَتِهَا. He says, and she was named Fatima because mankind has been weaned. When you have a baby and it's time to stop breastfeeding him, what do you do to him? You wean him. Tuftum. Sixth Imam comes and says, she was named Fatima. Why? Of course, many hadith, then she say something else. For example, because her Shia will be Yaftum Taftum Shi'ataha min al-Nar. For example, she will remove her Shia from hell. This hadith comes and says, إِنَّمَا سُمِّيَتْ فَاطِمَةً. She was named Fatima. Why? لِأَنَّ الْخَلْقَ فُطِمُوا عَنْ مَعْرِفَتِهَا. Because mankind has been weaned from her gnosis. So let's come and see what that hadith describes her as. When hadith comes and says, فَاطِمَة هِيَ حَوْرَاءٌ إِنْسِيَّةٌ. حَوْرَاءٌ إِنْسِيَّةٌ means what? Either you are an angel or you are a human being. Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him, Islam, who says, Fatima Zahra, salamu wa ta'ala alayha, hiya hawra'un insiyya, meaning she is a spiritual entity in a physical body. First hadith, that's very bothering me. Second hadith comes and says, Fatima Zahra, salamu wa ta'ala alayha, she's compared to what? To Laylatul Qadr. Hadith of Ahlul Bayt, salamu wa ta'ala alayhim. They come and they tell us, man adraka Fatima, faqad istadraka sirra Laylatul Qadr. He who knows Fatima, he will understand the secret of the night of power, Laylatul Qadr. Meaning, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and says, Inna anzalnahu fi Laylatul Qadr, wa ma adraka ma Laylatul Qadr. Laylatul Qadr khayrun min alf shahr, greater than 1,000 months. Meaning, the greatness of Laylatul Qadr, as difficult as it is to encompass, a day where our destiny is decreed, a day where your future is planned, a day where 1,000 months have been condensed. Hadith comes and says, you want to understand it? Look at the characteristics of Fatima Zahra salamu wa ta'ala alayha. Furthermore, another hadith that's very boggling, that describes just the greatness of this lady, salamu wa ta'ala alayha. It comes and tells us, who? 11th Imam, Imam Hassan ibn Ali al-Askari salamu wa ta'ala alayhi. Salamu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Imam Hassan al-Askari, salamu wa ta'ala alayhi, comes and he tells us, نَحْنُ حُجَّةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى النَّاسِ. We are the representatives of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon the people. وَأُمُّنَا فَاطِمَةً حُجَّةٌ عَلَيْنَا. He says, we are the representatives of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth. Yet as for the mother, our mother Fatima, وَأُمُّنَا, look how he refers to her, وَأُمُّنَا فَاطِمَةً. Biologically, she's not his mother. Yet look at the status which he gives her, وَأُمُّنَا فَاطِمَةً Hujjatullah alayna, meaning we imams are representatives of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala amongst the people. Yet Fatima is the representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon us. Meaning what imams are to you and I, Fatima is to the imams. Imagine what that says. How old was she? 20 years old. And people come and say, age is a factor. Furthermore, the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him, Islam, he comes and tells us, Fatima qutbur ruha. Fatima is what? She is the center. In the time of the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him, and his family, they had a ruha, a machine which was basically comprised of two layers of rocks, one upon the other, and it had a pole in the middle which would be churned around, which would cause the grain to be smoothened or crushed, we can say. Without that pole, the machine makes no sense. It can't be used. Prophet of Islam, peace be upon his family, he says, Fatima is that pole in that machine. Meaning, it makes no sense. Meaning, Islam as a religion without Fatima Zahra is what? Is an incomplete religion. That's why one of the most brain-boggling narrations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Hadith al-Qudsi, it comes and explains to us, furthermore, the greatness of Fatima Zahra, salamu wa ta'ala alayha. Yeah, before I come to that, we see that Islam is a religion which is called Islam, of the obvious, but it has a number of layers beneath it that allows the religion to be what it is. Let me explain myself. Imam comes and tells us you have Islam, yet beneath it there is Iman, there is Ikhlas, for example, there is Yaqeen. There's a number of layers which comprise the entirety of Islam, meaning the ingredients of Islam. Yet the furthest level and the highest echelon in degree of the religion in its entirety is a term which is known as wilaya. Why? Wilaya within the Holy Quran is used in a number of places. Literally, it means what? It means a transfer of authority. So if I want to understand Fatima Zahra, someone can ask a question, what does she have to do with wilaya? Okay, so we understand that wilaya is a transfer of authority from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him and his family, to the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, salamullah ta'ala alayhim ajma'in. A transfer of authority. It's like the baton that was mentioned previously. A transfer of authority from one entity to another. Therefore the question arises, were it not for Fatima Zahra, does she have anything to do with this transfer of authority amongst the prophets, amongst the imams, or no? Does she have nothing to do with it? Because if she has something to do with it, then we can conclude that if we understand wilaya, we understand Fatima Zahra, salamu wa ta'ala alayha. Okay, so wilaya comes from nubuwah to imamah, the transfer of authority. Nubuwah, after comes imamah. Wilaya is the process that transfers authority from one entity to the other. Let's see, is there a link between nubuwah and imamah? That were it not for this link, wilaya would not be able to take place. It's like, for example, you have two light bulbs and you need a cord to transfer electricity from one light bulb to another. The two light bulbs, as fancy as they are, if you don't have a strong connection, if there isn't that link between the two, it's impossible to transfer electricity from one light bulb to another. Or you may have two laptops, for example. You can have the best of laptops. Mac, whatever it is. So you have the laptop, and you can, it can be bedazzled, it can be the $1 million cover, it can be straight from Japan, that's where they're made. So you have the laptops. If there isn't a strong connection of Wi-Fi between the two laptops, it's impossible to transfer internet from one laptop to another. We come to wilaya, we come to ask the question, what was that missing link between nubuwa and imamah that we want to discover? That were it not for that link, wilaya would be impossible to be transferred from one entity to another. What was that individual, or who was that individual, that served as the missing link between the two entities? That were it not for it, wilaya would be impossible to be transferred. We come and we see, hadith once comes and explains to us that there are nearly two unique qualities that Fatima Zahra salamu wa ta'ala alayha had that distinguished her upon others. As for the first one, we see that death was not the end of Fatima salamu wa ta'ala alayha, and birth was not the beginning. Typically, a normal individual, birth is the beginning of him, and death is the end. As for Fatima Zahra, we see the exact opposite salamu wa ta'ala. Ta'ala alayha. Birth was not the beginning. In what sense? They would come and they ask the Prophet, explain to us, who is Fatima? He would say, Fatima, hiya nurun, she is a light under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we're going to ask a question, how do I even understand that she is a light? Yes, because she is too great to have this natural process, just as you and I, because her body is simply a representation of who she is. Yet greatness supersedes her as an individual. Therefore, Allah Ta'ala comes and says, birth was not the beginning of her. أَوَّلَ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ what? Nur Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. صَلُّ عَلَى مُحَمَّدُ وَآلِ مُحَمَّدُ أَوَّلَ مَا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ نُورُ مُحَمَدْ وَآلِ مُحَمَّدْ أَحْمَدْ كَمْ تَلْلُ. The first thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created was the light of Muhammad and Al Muhammad, meaning birth was not the beginning of Fatima Zahra salamu wa ta'ala alayha, and death is not the end. You and I, birth is the beginning, death is the end. Look at how death is not the end for Fatima Zahra salamu wa ta'ala alayha. They say in Yawm Al-Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open up the case of crimes that took place. So he would be questioning the people as to what they want justice to be brought to first. All of a sudden, the lady passes by. She begins to walk towards the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A voice is shouted in the heavens saying, غُضُّ أَبْصَارَكُمْ لِكَيْ تَمُرْ فَاطِمَ تُزَهْرَى سَلَامُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَلَيْهَا. Lower your gazes so that Fatima Zahra salamu wa ta'ala alayha could pass by. She passes by, she reaches the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she begins to speak. He asks her, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O Fatima, whose case do you want me to begin with first? Do you want me to begin with the case of Al-Hasan, your son, the poisoned? Salamu wa ta'ala alayhi. She would say, no. He would say, do you want me to begin with the case of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein? Salamu wa ta'ala alayhi. The dhabih fi Karbala? No. I don't want you to begin with him. Do you want me to begin with the musibah of Zainab? Salamu wa ta'ala alayha. Umm al-Masa'ib? No. Who do you want me to begin with first? They say she would have a tray in her hands. She would lift it towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She would remove the cover from the tray, and there would be two severed hands on this tray where she would begin to speak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying, Allah ya hakamu ya adl, Allahumma hakum bayni wa bayna qati'i hadhihi al-kufur. Shufufa. She would say, oh just, oh equal, judge between me and between the ones who cut these two arms, none other than Qamar al-Ashira, Abu Fadl al-Abbas, salamullah ta'ala alayhi. Therefore, her role, neither does it begin with birth, her existence, and neither does it end with death. The first distinguishing quality of Fatima Zahra, salamullah ta'ala alayha. Secondly, we see that as individuals, as humans, we've been created for a purpose. Yeah, there are some individuals who merged so closely with the purpose that they became the purpose itself. Let me explain. When it comes to Islam, some know Islam, meaning they have an understanding of what Islam is. Five usul al-deen, pray five times a day, fast in the holy month of Ramadan. They know Islam. Others have realized Islam. The first we can say are Muslims, for example. Second, have attained a level of realization. Meaning not only does he know Islam, but he realizes what Islam is. There's a sense of ma'rifa in the picture. These could be referred to as mu'mineen, for example. Third level, not only do they know the religion, not only have they understood the religion, but they have synchronized with the religion. Meaning what? They have merged, they have become one with the religions. These are what? Let's say, for example, muttaqeen, that he can go nowhere unless if he feels the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning it has become something embedded within him as an individual. Number three, ones who have synchronized. Number four, neither does he only know the religion, nor does he only understand the religion, nor does he simply synchronize with the religion, but he has what? He becomes a manifestation of the religion. I ask brothers and sisters, when Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah ta'ala alayhi, he would speak to the people telling them, سَلُونِي سَلُونِي قَبْلَ أَن تَفْقُدُونِي فَأَنِّي أَعْلَمُ بِطُرُقَ السَّمَاءِ. I know the pathways of the skies more than I know the pathways of the earth. They would tell him what? They would tell him how many pieces of hair on my beard. Yet the Imam would say, أَنَا الْقُرْآنُ النَّاطِقُ. I'm not only a reciter of Qur'an. I not only teach the Qur'an. Me, Ali, is Qur'an. I am what? I am the walking, speaking, breathing, moving Qur'an. Meaning anything within the Holy Qur'an is a reflection of my character. He's what? He has become the message. Meaning now we come to Fatima Zahra, salamullah ta'ala alayha. We see, not only does she strive for a purpose in her life, she herself has become a purpose. What do I mean? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would be in the heavens and he would come to Adam. He would tell him, Ya Adam, were it not for two individuals, I would not have created you. The first being Muhammad and the second being Ali ibn Abi Talib, salamullah ta'ala alayhi. Allahumma
salli ala Muhammad wa alihi.
Meaning you, Ya Adam, your purpose of existence is to prepare for them. I want you to prepare the people for the coming of Ahlul Bayt, salamullah ta'ala alayhim, as I mentioned to you before. Therefore, Adam has been created to serve Muhammad and Ali, salamullah ta'ala alayhim, ajma'in. Yet Muhammad and Ali would not have been created were it not for Fatima. If the existence of Adam depends on Muhammad and Ali, then the existence of Muhammad and Ali depends on Fatima. Somebody says, how could you say such a thing? Hadith 20 comes in Tazib, which has been mentioned many times on our Manabir, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would come to the Holy Prophet of Islam, telling him, Ya Ahmad, lawla kalama khalaqtun aflak. He would say, were it not for you, Ya Ahmad, I would not have created the galaxies or the universe. Walawla aliyun lama khalaqtuk. Were it not for Ali, I would not have created you, O Muhammad. Walawla Fatima lama khalaqtukuma. And were not for Fatima, salamullah ta'ala alayha, I would not have created the both of you. Somebody comes and says, I've heard this hadith many times. Yet how does the existence of Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam and Ali ibn Abi Talib sallallahu ta'ala alayhi depend on Fatima? Where's Fatima? Neither is she a prophet nor is she an imam. We go back to wilayah. We come to ask the question. Prophets have been sent to complete wilayah. Imams have been sent to do what? To transfer this idea of authority from one imam to the other. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and says, Adam was sent to initiate wilayah, to continue it to the next prophet. Ibrahim, to continue wilayah, give it to the next prophet. Nuh ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa alayhi wa sallam jami'an came with this wilayah to give it to the next prophet, and so on and so forth, until it reaches what? Until it reaches imamah. Therefore, firstly, to establish when somebody comes and says wilayah is only for the Shia of Ahlul Bayt salamu wa ta'ala alayhim. No. Wilayah is something that's adam ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa alayhi salam, initiated. Someone says, okay, then what happened on Eid al-Ghadir? Eid al-Ghadir was simply the completion. It was the icing on the cake. That's why the prophet comes in, or the poet, he comes and explains very nicely. He comes and he says, wilayah was initiated when the angels went down. Huh? And it was completed when the hand went up on the 18th of Dhul Hijjah. Meaning, wilayah is something continuous from prophet to prophet, from imam to imam. Imam Amir al-Mu'min salamu wa ta'ala, what did he do? When the hand was raised on the 18th of Dhul Hijjah, the Prophet Islam, peace be upon his family, was coming back from Hajjatul Wada', what was he doing? It wasn't simply an initiation of wilayah. This isn't when the wilayah reached a level of commencement. It's not when it began. It's when it was completed, that when the hand was raised by the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon his family, saying, أَلَسْتُ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ قَالُوا بَلَى. Then he would continue. He would say, أَلَا مَنْ كُنْتُ مَوْلَاهُ فَهَذَا عَلِيٌّ مَوْلَاهُ اللَّهُمَّ وَالِي مَنْ وَالَاهُ وَعَادِ مَنْ عَادَاهُ وَانْصُرْ مَنْ نَصَرَهُ وَاخْذُلْ مَنْ خَذَلَهُ. That instance was there, was the icing on the cake of this wilayah. Yet we come and we ask the question, wilayah being a transfer of authority from prophet to imam, is there a link in between it that were not for that link, that process would be impossible to take place? We come and we see one individual. I'll come and ask you a number of questions. And hopefully, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a name will come in your mind, so that we can continue in the research. Who was the lady that Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, who manifested Imam salamu wa ta'ala alayhi, would come back to in the house and forget his wounds the minute he would see her? Oh, there's a name that comes to the mind. Look at the connection she had with Imamat, to make it clear, how were it not for this individual, the two would have difficulty to connect, if not impossibility to connect. Who is the individual that would be the first lady? But when I said lady, I gave it away. Who is the first individual that when the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him and his family, would leave Medina, he would see her? And who is the first or the last individual who the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him, his family, would see the minute he comes back to Medina? A name pops up in the mind. Who is the lady that was the only individual who understood the secrets and the mysteries of Ali ibn Abi Talib salamu wa ta'ala? Do you know what they tell us of Amir al-Mu'mineen salamu wa ta'ala? He would go to the desert, he would plunge his fist in the ground, and he would begin to speak to the ground, giving it its secrets, giving it his mysteries, giving it that knowledge. He would point to his chest, he would say, Hahuna ilmun jamma. He would say, in this heart of mine, in this chest of mine, there is profound knowledge, but I have nobody to give it to you. That's why they say that there are certain individuals who lived in a time different than a time which they were supposed to live in. The Christian comes and says, and one of those individuals was Ali ibn Abi Talib salamu wa ta'ala alayhi. There was a gap between the nation and society. How many times have we seen the nation is on one level, the society is on a different level? Of course, the goal of the nation, of the leader, is to try to pick them up, to bring them to his level. Yet many times, it's a difficult task. When we come and we speak about the government of our 12th Imam, ajalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif, what's so special about it is that it's the closest that society will be to the level of the leader, the Imam. Hence you see many right now, when I mentioned the name of Imam, and again right now, ajalallahu subhanahu wa ta'ala farajahu sharif, we put our hands on our head. Why? Because some ahadith come and say that the Imam will place his head, his hand, salamu wa ta'ala alayhi, on the head of the believers, and instantly their intellectual level will rise to a peak. He will begin to raise. Some people think that, especially the enemies of Islam, they have a field day with this notion that when the Imam comes, our Messiah, when he comes, he's going to be slaughtering left, right, and center. And this is how he's going to establish peace on this world. We come to say there's going to be minimal bloodshed. But what the Imam is going to do, salamu wa ta'ala alayhi, he's going to raise the intellectual status of the people. Because the minute the intellects are risen, no bloodshed is needed. The only reason why Abu Abdullah al-Husayn salamullah ta'ala alayhi would go to Karbala and do what he did, give his life, carry the sword, otherwise the Imam was a man of peace, no doubt, and the Bayt salamullah ta'ala alayhim were all advocates of peace. Yet this was the only resort. That's why our first Imam salamullah ta'ala alayhi comes and he says, very interestingly speaking about ignorant individuals, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from those who are ignorant. He comes and he says, "La yadur al-jahla illa haddul husam." He says, nothing can fight ignorance except the edge of the sword. Because what are you going to do? Imam comes and says, "Ma jadaltu aliman illa wa ghalabtu, wa ma jadalani jahilan illa wa ghalabani." He says, I've never debated a scholar unless if I've defeated him. And I've never debated an ignorant unless if he defeated me. Because an ignorant individual, you have to go down to his level. A wise person says, I refuse to go down to your level. I want to raise you to my level, huh? وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا. Ibadul, the slaves, the servants of the most beneficent are those that when they pass by ignorance or ignorant individuals, they say, peace. Therefore, you come and you see that the Imam, he said, I refuse to go down to the level of the people. We come back to our topic. Therefore, this missing individual, which we said was the only one who understood the Imam, because there was a gap between society and the leader, is none other than Fatima Zahra salamullah ta'ala alayha. Therefore, the ethos of this lady is wilayah. Perhaps one of the greatest accomplishments in her existence and what gave importance and an imperative nature to her existence is that she was what? She served as that missing link between Imamah and Nubuwa. Therefore, we come to ask the fundamental question. I want to understand her. I need to understand wilayah. What does the Quran come and say about wilayah? Now, of course, this topic is something that not only benefits me to understand who Fatima Zahra salamullah ta'ala alayha is, but it benefits me to stand with confidence in front of people of different sects. Now, of course, we don't advocate hatred between people of different sects. For goodness sake, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks highly of Jews and Christians. Then how about the Muslims? Yet he stands knowing that what he believes in is something correct. So as much as a human being portrays humility and portrays respect and portrays tolerance, which is perhaps the best way to explain it, towards other people of different views, at the same time, at the back of his mind, he should know how to explain his beliefs, lest one moment he'll be challenged. And the minute he's challenged, resorting to an emotional explanation is very, it holds little weight. Because why? Because especially people who have hatred towards Ahlul Bayt, specific individuals, when you give him resources from his book, which is one of the greatest things of the religion of Islam, Islam is perhaps, if not for certain, the only religion that's able to prove its beliefs through other books before its books. We can prove Islam through the Bible. The Christian can't prove Christianity in the Quran. We can prove Islam in the Torah. The Jew cannot prove Judaism in the Quran. We can prove Shi'ism in books of our respected brothers and sisters, yet they can't prove their books, their views in our books. Meaning what? Because we believe we're the last religion. We're not only the last, we're the only religion. Inna deena and Allah, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Inna deena and Allah. And Islam, the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is Islam. Therefore, there has to be what? This sense of confidence. Where does that confidence come from? When the very Quran agrees with what we believe in. Because many times there is a resort to the narrations. Narrations are secondary to the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and says, I am the litmus test. You want to know if Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib salamu ta'ala alayhi makes sense? Come back to the Quran. So the Lord says, how can you say such a thing? You look at the very hadith of the Imam himself salamu ta'ala alayhi, or the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon his family, he comes and he says, anything that we say, if it goes against the Quran, don't take it. فَضْرُبُوهُ عَلَى الْحَاقِبِ. Throw it against the wall. Why? Because we are that which are reflectors of the message of Islam, which is the whole manifested within the Holy Quran. We are the moons of the sun being the Holy Quran. Therefore, we come to the Holy Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in two different verses, he establishes the importance of wilayah. In one verse, he establishes it. In a second verse, he clarifies it. Sometimes that's questioned. Why does he give me two verses? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that there are going to come people later in time who are going to strive to change what the Holy Quran is saying. Because Christianity fell victim to this disease of an alteration of the script of their book. Judaism fell as victims to this disease, where people begin to inject their own two cents worth within the teachings of the Bible. You look at St. Paul himself, he comes and he says, speaking about the Trinity, where God could be separated into three entities, astaghfirullah, he comes and he says, I say this. Jesus doesn't say it, God doesn't say it, I say it. Ajeeb. St. Paul, with all due respect, can you please tell me who you are? Are you a prophet? Are you an imam? Have you been appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No. He says, I receive inspiration. For goodness sake, you are a murderer. You are a mass murderer, for goodness sake. So I'm all of it's very interesting how we are the religion of terrorism. With all due respect, we are the religion of terrorism. Yet, one of the most important individuals in your religion is a mass murderer. But he repented, alhamdulillah. And everything became better. For goodness sake, if a president was running, if a man was running for president, and he was a previous murderer, yet he repented for 24 years, doesn't matter how much you repented, would you vote for him as a president? I know, I wouldn't, I hope none of you would. Yet, a mass murderer becomes what? He becomes the representative of the religion in its entirety. So Christianity fell victim to this. Today, where is the real Bible? You'll find different sects. The Catholics have their version, the Protestants have their version, and so on and so forth. You come to see Judaism, how many different versions of the book are there? We are the only religion, brothers and sisters, and I really hope that this gives us a sense of confidence. We are the only religion under the sun in the universe that has the same book that was sent to the Prophet. This same Quran that we have, that you see here, this same Quran that we have in our hands, in our houses, on our shelves, is the same Quran that was sent to Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and warns us from these individuals. Where? In Surah Al-Imran, verse number 7, he says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Huwa alladhi anzala alayka al-kitab. Hunna ayatul muhkamat. مِنْهُ آيَاتُ الْمُحْكَمَاتُ هُنَّ أُمُّ الْكِتَابِ وَأُخَرُ مُتَشَابِهَاتِ فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْغٌ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ مَا تَشَابَهَ مِنْهُ ابْتِغَاءَ الْفِتْنَةِ وَابْتِغَاءَ تَأْوِيلِهِ وَمَا يَعْلَمُ تَأْوِيلَهُ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَالرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ يَقُولُونَ آمَنَّا بِهِ كُلٌّ مِنْ عِنْدِ رَبِّنَا وَمَا يَذَّكَّرُ إِلَّا أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ رَبَّنَا لَا تُزِغْ قُلُوبَنَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and says that the Holy Quran is comprised of two different verses. Muhkamat, mutashabih, fixed verses and allegorical ones. Fixed verses, for example, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ. Neither Shi'i nor Sunni can come and disagree with the message that this verse is sending. Yet then you have other verses that are perhaps allegorical, not so clear. They make a reference to an individual without a mention of a name. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, عَبَسَ وَتَوَلَّى. He frowned and turned away. Said, who frowned? Who turned away? That's up for discussion. Yeah, what's interesting is that you'll see this, as some have referred to it, parenthetical terrorism. It's really parenthetical terrorism. He, parentheses, the Prophet, frowned and turned away. Then with all due respect, who said the Prophet turned away? Did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say that? Well, there's two narrations. You decide to raise the companion over the Prophet. Where's the logic in that? He frowned and turned away. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and says, those who have a disease in their heart, فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ زَيْغٌ فَيَتَّبِعُونَ مَا تَشَابَهَ مِنْهُ ابْتِغَاءَ الْفِتْنَةِ. Those who have a disease in their heart, they follow the mutashabih. Why? ابْتِغَاءَ الْفِتْنَةِ. Number one, to spread disunity. Fitna amongst the people. Is that it? No. وَابْتِغَاءَ تَأْوِيلِهِ. And to change its essential meaning. Who are those who are spreading fitna? It's very clear in the world, brothers and sisters. All we need to do is open up the TV and we see people who claim to love the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon his family, yet they are the very ones exhuming bodies of the companions of the Prophet, such as Hijr ibn Adi, it came deep. So we say they didn't exhume it. The fact that you would attempt to do such a thing shows how much of a disease exists in your heart. Those who say, we love the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon his family, but we're going to attack the dome, huh, of the daughter of his cousin, Zainab ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib, salamu wa ta'ala alayhi. Those who say, we love the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon his family, oh, we love him so much, yet we're going to go and burn the malqat of Ja'far ibn Abi Talib in Jordan. How does that work? Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. Huh? When you say one thing, but your heart and actions portray the exact opposite, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and says, therefore you'll see those with diseases in their heart. What are they going to do? They're going to begin to follow the mutashabih. Ibtigha al-fitna wa ibtigha ta'wilih. Therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He came and He gave us not only one verse that establishes the importance of wilaya, but a second verse that clarifies it. Perhaps there are any doubters. First verse, I'm going to give you two verses, brothers and sisters, and these two verses are essential in proving the wilaya that we believe in through the Holy Quran. Because when I come to a brother from a different sect, I'm not going to begin to give him hadith after hadith. Perhaps I'll get to that point, but I first begin with a element which we both tend to agree with. Therefore, Allah Ta'ala comes and tells us, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, chapter 4, verse 59. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuha al-ladhina amanu. Ati'u Allah, wa ati'u al-Rasul, wa uli al-amri minkum. Okay. Allah Ta'ala comes and gives me how many people? Three different groups. Only who believe. Ati'u Allah. Obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And obey the Prophet. وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. Okay, obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understood. That's what Islam is, built upon it, and they correct it all. وَأَضِعُ الرَّسُولِ. Follow the Prophet. Understood, Nubuwa is essential. It's what explains Tawheed to me, yes? وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ. He said, who are أُولِي الْأَمْرِ? This is where discussion comes. But first, when you look at the grammatical strategy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala displays in this verse, there's something very clear that pops up to the one who reads between the lines. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes and says, O you who believe, number one, obey me, ati'u Allah. Wa, this wa is essential. Wa ati'u Rasul, wa al-idafa, wa ati'u Rasul, and follow the Prophet. Wa, did he say, ati'u ulil amr, and also obey ulil amr? No. He only said wa ulil amr. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you said ati'u Allah, okay, obey Allah. He used the word obey. Wa ati'u ar-rasul, you used the word obey. Wa, he'll say ati'u ulil amr. No, he said automatically wa ulil amr minkum. Ya Allah, why did you do such a thing? He's sending a message. He's saying ita'ah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may come, but you may not do ita'ah to the Prophet. Therefore, I'm going to come and tell you wa ati'u ar-rasul. A separate stage of obedience needs to be given to the Prophet than that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yet with ulil amr, they are a very specific group whose ita'ah will be automatically given to if you give correct ita'ah to Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Therefore, he comes and he says, it makes no sense for me to say wa ati'u ulil amri minkum. What am I going to do? I'm going to simply say, and those vested with authority. Therefore, this comes down as a very powerful message. Ulil amr are individuals who everything that they have done does not contradict one action of the Prophet of Islam. Who are these ulil amr? Could it be an individual who claimed power after the authority, after the death of the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon his family? Let's see, perhaps, maybe it's possible. Let's see his actions. Prophet comes in and says temporary marriage is acceptable. He comes in and says what? He says absolutely haram. He comes and says mut'atan, two mut'az, hajj al-tamattu' and mut'at al-zawaj. I come and I make it what? Forbidden. Then my brother, well, the Prophet said it's acceptable, peace upon his family. Why are you going to say the exact opposite? Therefore, clearly, it cannot be such an individual, whoever it may be. Could it be ulama in the time of the Prophet? No, because ulama are infallible, they made mistakes in their lifetime. Could it be the judges? No, judges are infallible in their lifetime, cannot be them. Therefore, it's a specific group of individuals who did nothing except reflect the message of the Prophet of Islam. An individual who's in such battles would be the front runner when it came to such battles. You know, in such battles, the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him and his family, he would come and he would have the banner in his hand and he would say, I'm waiting for an individual who can take this banner from me. First individual comes. Is it me, Ya Rasulullah? No. Stand on the side. Second individual. Is it me, Ya Rasulullah? No. Stand on the side. Third individual. Is it me, Ya Rasulullah? No. Stand on the side. He comes to them and tells them, could you please bring me Ali? Not to bother you. Could you bring me Ali ibn Abi Talib? They would say, of course, we can, Ya Rasulullah. But just to tell you, he has an infection in his eye. Imam Yawmumin, as you know, on that day, he had red eye. It was difficult for him to see. He would say, I didn't ask if he had red eye or not. I told you to bring him to me. They would bring Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen to where the Prophet of Islam made reference to him on the previous day, where he said, غَدًا سَأُعْطِ الرَّايَ لِرَجُلًا كَرَّارٌ غَيْرَ فَرَّارٌ يُحِبُّ اللَّهُ وَيُحِبَّ عَنَا. He said, tomorrow I'll give this banner to an individual who goes to the battlefield, never comes back defeated. يُحِبُّ اللَّهُ وَيُحِبَّ عَنَا. He loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet love him. They say that Imam would come with that infection in his eye. He would take saliva from his blessed mouth, sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. He would place it on the eye of Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullah ta'ala alayhi. Imam says, I never had better vision than I did on that day. Ulil Amr, perhaps, is referring to such an individual. Ulil Amr may be referring to an individual who slept in the bed of the Prophet of Islam besides him. He would sleep in the very bed. They would come, all 40 of them, bloodthirsty, expecting to see Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the bed. They remove the blanket. They see the head of, they see the body of Amir al-Mu'mineen sallallahu alayhi. He would stand up. He would say, whoever wants his flesh to be separated from his bones, walk forward. Of course, nobody was had the guts to walk forward because they were used to running away from battlefields. Ulil Amr may be referring to such an individual. Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'm not going to stop there. I gave you 459. I mentioned Ulul Amr. Ulil Amr. I'm going to clarify it for you. I'm going to give you chapter 5, verse 55 a little bit more. Perhaps you have any doubt. I'm going to give you one last blow to explain it to you. He comes and tells us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, chapter 5, verse 55. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, innama waliyukum. Allah wa rasuluhu walladhina amanu. Your wali, same derivative word, ulul amr, innama waliyukum. Innama, your wali, your authority is who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa rasuluhu, and his prophet. Oh Allah, please. Walladhina amanu. He says, and those who believe, please don't keep it anonymous. Please give me something specific so that I can go back home knowing who these ulul amr are, knowing who the true authority was after the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon him and his family. He comes and he tells us, الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. Those who establish prayer, Ya Allah, please give me more. A lot of people establish prayer. وَيُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ. وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةِ. They give charity. Please, Allah. No, everyone, a lot of people give charity. Give me more. يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةِ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةِ وَهُمْ رَاكِعُونَ. If there was any doubt, it should be removed at this last tail of the verse, where he said, they do salah, they give charity, all while being in ruku'ah. Today, brothers and sisters, you go back home, you study any book of our respected brothers and sisters, be it Bukhari, be it Tirmidhi, be it Sunan Abu Dawood, be it Ibn Majah, any book under the sky for our respected brothers, all six of them, you'll see no verse makes a reference to an individual giving charity while in ruku'ah, other than Amir al-Mu'mineen, Sayyid al-Muhadin, Asadullah al-Ghalib, Muthhir al-Ajaib, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Salamullah ta'ala alayhi. Said, I'm not going to leave any more doubt. Hope. Excellent. That's why when we come and we see the reference in our ahadith to this term wilaya, we see an importance given to it like nothing else. Our fifth imam cousin tells us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the believers and his creations to give authority and to give respect to five different things. Salah, Sawm, Hajj, Zakat, and wilaya. He says one of the most unfortunate things is that they paid respect to the first four things, but they neglected the fifth, which was what? Wilaya. That's why I tell you one of the most interesting narrations that furthermore establishes the importance of this concept is when our eighth imam comes and tells us, salamullah ta'ala alayhi. He comes and he says the similitude. He gives a very interesting comparison between those who decided to back away from accepting authority of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen salamu ta'ala alayhi, and to those who refused, or to that one individual, one creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who refused to prostrate down to Adam ala nabiyyina wa ala alihi wa alayhi salam. Imam Qadim says, he says, the similitude of those who refused to give bay'ah to Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, or those who backed away from his authority even later on, are the same as those who refused to prostrate down to Adam. He continues. He says, and the similitude of those who accepted the wilayah of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen salamu ta'ala alayhi could be compared to those who did prostrate down to Adam. If I'm not mistaken, the individual who didn't prostrate down to Adam ala nabiyyina wa ala ali wa alayhi salam was who? Shaytan. There he comes and he says, those who backed away from this, what is the Imam telling us? He's telling us the line between angels and devils is wilayah. The line between haqq and batil is wilayah. The line between truth and falsehood is wilayah. That's why the Prophet of Islam, peace be upon his family, he would come to Imam Amir al-Mu'minin salamu ta'ala alayhi, and he would tell him, Ya Ali, ma ahabbaka illa mu'min, wa ma abghadaka illa munafiq. He would say, Oh Ali, nobody loves you except for a believer, and nobody hates you except for a munafiq. Meaning there's an importance given to this wilayah. That's why when somebody, some Joshua comes and begins to question why we have this extravagant, if they want to explain it in that way, love towards Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen salamu wa ta'ala alayhi, we simply come and say that not only is it something secondary, because some may think it's something secondary. Love for Ahlul Bayt salamu wa ta'ala alayhim is secondary. You want to love them? Excellent, very good. You don't want to love them? That's your choice. Yet you'll still perhaps go to Jannah. No, it doesn't work like that. The hadith comes and tells us, to everything there is a foundation. And the foundation of Islam is love for us, Ahlul Bayt. Meaning it's not that Allah created existence, that he saw five individuals and he said, you know what? Let me make them part of the religion. No. He created the five individuals and upon them existence was established. Huh? The five lights were there and universe was established upon them. Therefore today, what is my role in giving importance to this wilayah? What can I do to pay heed towards this concept of wilayah? Is it simply a theoretical discussion? No. It can be a very practical one. How? By recognizing who wilayah is, where wilayah is today, in whose hands is it. We realize, brothers and sisters, that we have a role in spreading justice on this earth, in giving preparation towards the coming of our 12th Imam, Ajalullah Ta'ala, Farajuhu Sharif. And let us not think, brothers and sisters, not for a minute, hopefully that our Imam is in some distant land, not seeing what's happening to the Shia. Do we think he's not seeing what's happening in Bahrain, to the Shia of Ahlul Bayt salamu wa ta'ala alayhim? Do we think that he's not seeing what's happening in Egypt, the audacity that they had in amputating the body of Hassan Shhata? Do we think that he's not seeing what's happening in the world, from corruption and greed to where 99% in their finance are equivalent to 1%? Does he not see this greed? No, he sees it. But he cries blood when he says, لَأَنْدُبَنَّكَ صَبَاحًا وَمَسَاءً وَلَأَبْكِيَنَّ عَلَيْكَ بَدَلَ الدُّمُوعِ دَمًا. We come to ask the question, did he only cry for Aba Abdullah al-Husayn salamu wa ta'ala alayhi? Perhaps he cried blood for him salamu wa ta'ala alayhi. But he also cries when he sees the situation of the Shia. Why does he cry? For one reason he cries, because he sees it, yet he cannot directly go and affect it, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not give him the green light yet. And for a second reason he may cry, because he sees Shia who scream his name, who place their hand on their head the minute his name is mentioned, ajalallah ta'ala farajahu sharif, yet they don't take action when they see something wrong taking place in the world. Yet he's there and he knows what's happening. That's why they say there was once a man in Iraq who was in the Sijn of Abu Ghraib. He was tortured to such an extent that he began to fall unconscious. He fell unconscious and he saw the Imam Adalallah Ta'ala Farajul Sharif in his dream. He would tell him, Ya Imam, you see them whipping me whip after whip. And you know, Ba'athis, very generous in their torture. He would say, you see what they're doing to me. Oh Imam, why don't you help me? I'm your Shia. Am I not? How many times did I say, Adrikni ya sahib al-zaman? Did you not hear me? He would say, no, I heard you. He'd say, why didn't you do anything? Help me. He would say, how many times did they whip you on your back? He would say, they whipped me, Ya Imam, 100 times, and you know better than me. He would say, remove the shirt from your back. He would remove the shirt, he would turn around, and he would tell him, count the number of whips on your back. He said he would count them, and he would see simply 10 whips on his back. He would tell me, Ya Imam, what do you mean? Why is there only... Imam would turn around, he would remove his shirt, and he would show him his back. He would tell him, who do you think took the other 90 whips from the Ba'athis? Huh? Therefore, the Imam is there, and he knows what's happening, Hasan. Yet he depends on us to hasten his appearance. Because just as he is Muntadhar, he is Muntadhar as well. Just as he is the awaited, he is waiting for us as well. More than us, brothers and sisters, waiting for the Imam, Adilullah Ta'ala, Farju Sharif, Imam is waiting for us as well. He's saying, I'm Ma'soom. It's not a matter of me being ready. Some people can say, he's going to come out when he's ready. No. He was born Ma'soom. He was established as a Ma'soom at the tender age of five. Huh? He knew he was Ma'soom. Yet he's waiting for us to spread that red carpet for him to come and establish his mission and to start it. Yeah, on nights like this, just as the Imam Salamullah Ta'ala alayhi cries because of what's happening in the world, and he waits for us to do something to prepare his reappearance, he also cries because on nights like this, his grandmother Fatima is having soil poured on her head. She's having the dirt covering her body. I only ask the question, how could Ali ibn Abi Talib salamullah ta'ala alayhi not cry every time he sees his hands? And with those same hands, he buried the body of Fatima Zahra salamullah ta'ala alayha. Imam Sahib al-Zaman, ajalallah ta'ala, Fawzul Sharif, had a very strong relationship with Fatima Zahra salamullah ta'ala alayha. That's why when reference is made in our hadith to the Imam, it doesn't say Ya'ti al-Mahdi min wildi Narjis. No. It doesn't say Ya'ti al-Mahdi from the sons of Narjis, who is his biological mother. No. Ya'ti al-Mahdi min wildi Fatima wa ma'ahu al-Masih Isa ibn Maryam yamla'u al-ardha qistan wa 'adla ba'da an muli'at dhulman wa jawra, as the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, huh? So there was a relation. Why does it say Fatima? Because the Imam says, I will come. And one of the main reasons why I'm coming back is to give justice to those who broke the ribs of my mother Fatima Zahra salamuha ta'ala alayha. They come and they say that Sayyid Baqir al-Qarashi radhiyallahu ta'ala alayhi, on Eid al-Ghadir, he saw 12th Imam ajallahu ta'ala farju sharif in his dream, and he would tell him, Ya Imam, you're crying on Eid al-Ghadir? Well, this is the greatest Eid, Eidullah al-Akbar, as it is referred to. You're crying. It's a happy event. Why do you cry? To where the Imam would reply with a famous line of poetry. He would say, وَلَا تَرَانِي بَعْدَ دَارُ الْأَحْزَانِ أَبْقَى فِي دَارِ سُرُورِ. He would say, you'll never see me after the house of sorrows sitting in a house of joy. He would say, you'll never see a smile on my face after what they did to my mother Fatima Zahra salamullah ta'ala alayha. We come and we see furthermore, in a dream, A'lama would see him and he would tell him, Ya Sahib al-Zaman, you mentioned in Ziyarat al-Nahi, you'll cry day and night, أَبْكِيَنَّكَ صَبَاحًا وَمَسَاءً وَلَا أَبْكِيَنَّ عَلَيْكَ بَدَلَ الدُّمُعِدَ. Who do you refer to? He told him, do you refer to Abu Abdullah al-Husayn salamullah ta'ala alayhi? He told him, no. If he was here, he would cry as well. He would tell him, do you refer to Ali al-Akbar al-Shabih, Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam? He would say, no. If he was here, he would cry as well. He told him, do you cry about Zainab? He would tell him, that's the name I'm crying about. He would tell him two words only. Ammati Zainab, Ammati Zainab, Abki ala Ammati Zainab. Yet I ask the question, I tell him, Ya Sahib al-Zaman, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hasten your appearance. You cry because of Zaynab, yet Zaynab did not have nails pierced into her chest. What would you have done if you saw the chest of your grandmother Fatima Zahra salamullah ta'ala alayha? The love that she had for her father Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. They say when Bilal al-Habashi would say Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, she would fall unconscious, crying and screaming, saying, stop mentioning the name of my father. The minute you mention him, all of the memories we had together begin to cross my mind. Do you know what she would do? She would come to Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah ta'ala alayhi. She would tell him, Ya Ali, bring me the shirt which you used to wash the body of your cousin Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. She would take that shirt, she would put it on her face and she'd begin to smell it, remembering the scent of her father Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Yet furthermore, she would go even to his shrine. She would complain to him. She would tell him, Ya Rasulullah, the companions which you left behind to protect me are the very ones who have the audacity to crush my ribs. And she would begin to recite these famous lines of poetry, as some have reported her to say, Mada ala man shamatu urbanta ahmadin. Brothers and sisters, this is the last night we have with Fatima salamullah ta'ala alayha. These are lines which they tell us she mentioned salamullah ta'ala alayha. Let us recite it with her all together, imagining us to be next to the shrine of Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, saying with Fatima, Mada ala man shamatu urbanta ahmadin. يشم مدى الزمان غواليا يا أبا صبت علي مصائب لو أنا ما أسمع شباب أبا صبت علي مصائب لو أنا صبت على الأيام صرنا لياليا والزهرة صبت على الأيام صرنا ليالي Fatima salamullah ta'ala alayha. These are the last times you'll see her. Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen mentions in hadith, he says, wal aishu alladhi aashahu Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. When al-Hasan and al-Husayn alayhuma salam walked towards the shrine of their mother Fatima, towards that grave, they say that the coffin would open up, she would remove her hands, and she would say, ta'alu ta'alu ilayya ya waladi. تعالوا تعالوا إلي يا أولادي إمام الحسن would go next to the head of his mother فاطمة عليه السلام إمام الحسين would go up on the chest of his mother فاطمة saying أمه أمه فاطمة كلميني أمه أمه أنا الحسين كلميني أبا عبد الله. You were up on the chest of your mother Fatima, yet who was upon your chest in Karbala. She would tell him, Ya Amir al-Mu'min,
mu'mineen, come next to me. I have some wills to give you before I leave this world. Hada wasiyya. She would tell him, Ya Ali, firstly I plead, I ask you, take care of Hassan al-Hussein, salamullah ta'ala alayhim. After I leave this world, make sure Zainab alayhi salam is content. And O Ali, amongst other things she would mention, come to my grave every night and recite verses from the Holy Quran. They say that Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen would tell her, no problem, Ya Fatima. They say that Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen would put her in the night time. They would leave, huh? With only a few members carrying the shrine, carrying the grave of Fatima, salamullah ta'ala alayha. They say Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen would be in the front, companions would also be holding the grave, and there was nobody holding the grave in the back. The companion would turn to Amir al-Mu'mineen, salamullah ta'ala alayhi. He would say, Ya Ali, who's holding the grave of Fatima when there is no one there? He would say, these are the angels carrying the grave of Fatima al-Zahra, salamullah ta'ala alayha. They would bury Fatima laylan, yet the Imam would come back and he would open up the verses of the Holy Quran. He would begin reading until the Imam, salamullah ta'ala alayhi, would fall asleep. Fatima, salamullah ta'ala alayha, would come to him. She would say, Oh Ali, hurry up and go to the house. He would tell her, Ya Fatima, I rarely could see you anymore. This is the only relationship I have with you, reciting Quran for you. Why do you want me to go back to the house? She would tell him, Zainab, Zainab woke up from her sleep. لقد فاقت زينب من النوم ارجع إليها يا علي. You know, when they took the body of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah ta'ala alayhi back to his house after he was drunk, he would tell them, don't let me enter the house, take me back to the masjid. They would tell him why. He would say, inni ara Zainab waqifa ala al-bab. I see Zainab standing next to the door. Tigil abuya al-bab badla shlon abiyat. Tigil abuya al-bab badla. Crying, he would see her screaming, saying, Aynak ya umma, aynak ya Fatima, ummi Fatima, aynak ya Ali. You were there, Ya Ali ibn Abi Talib, to see Zainab when she woke up from the dream. Bas in atbak, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, where were you when Zainab was in Karbala? You were able to stop her from crying when she woke up from her sleep. Yet were you able to stop the hand of Shimr from slapping her on her blessed cheeks, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen? You were able to stop from crying, Ya Ali, Ya Ali. But did you remove the fire that was on the dress of Fatima? تقلنا أنا شقولا للي جاجدني من الناس وين أخوك حسين وين عباوان Salam after the Masa'ib of Karbala, she would see the shadow coming towards her. Huh? She would tell him, Oh shadow, أقسم عليك بالرب الذي تعبده لا تؤذيني. I swear upon you by the Lord that you worship, don't harm me. The shadow would continue to come closer to Zainab alayhi salam. Once again she would say, أقسم عليك بالرب الذي تعبده لا تؤذيني, don't harm me. He would continue to come closer. She would tell him, Ya hada أنا زينب بنت أمير المؤمنين. Do you know what the shadow would say? He would say, Zainab, don't tell me who you are. I'll tell you that because I am Ali, your father. She tells him, Ya Ali, where were you when they pierced the neck of Ali al-Asghar wa wali? Ya Ali, where were you when they Yadayka, the arms that brought me from Medina. Ya Haliwa, when they ripped the earrings from the ears of Sukaila. Ya Ali, ay wadawi wadawi, lisan hal al hawra Zainab, wadawi. وإنا إليه راجعون لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم اللهم نسألك بفاطمة وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها بعدد ما أحاط به علمك يا الله 10 مرات سوية يا الله يا الله يا الله ارفعوا الأيادي يا موالين يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله يا الله بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. There's no doubt that we have in this majlis perhaps people who are sick or they have relatives who are sick. I myself know a brother in California who was very active and unfortunately can't be anymore because he's been diagnosed with tongue cancer, if I'm not mistaken. And all of the mu'mineen and mu'minat across the world who have an iota of love for Ahlul Bayt in their hearts, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to cure them and to hasten the reappearance of our 12th and awaited Imam ajalallahu ta'ala farajuhu sharif wa yaqdhi al-hajat bil ayat al-mubarakah amma yujib sawiyatan bismillahir rahmanir rahim amma yujibu المضطر إذا دعا أمن يجيب أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعا ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب One last time, أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعا يا إن كان شف السوء اكشف السوء عنا يا الله اللهم شافي كل مريض بحق مريضك بلا زين العابدين اللهم اقضي حوائج المحتاجين لا سيما الحاضرين وأمواتهم اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج واجعلنا من أنصاره وأعوانه والمستشهدين بين يدي والاستجابة الدعاء ودفع البلاء. This is the last night of these three programs which we have had. Brothers and sisters together have brought efforts, their efforts and their juhud together to make this majlis a possibility. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept the rahmah. There are many names to mention. I'll mention Sayyid Haydar Nasrallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yuhufza for his efforts and his family and all of the mu'mineen and mu'minat. Forgive me if I don't mention anybody else's name, but many people have come together, Hay'at Shabab Al-Akbar in its entirety, who has come together and made these majalis possible. I know they're perhaps known for doing majalis Fatemiyah. Hopefully, inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the future, they'll have Layali Ashra, Ramadan, and this Mokib and all other hay'at, inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give success to them, because at the end of the day, the message is one, the purpose is one, and the goal is one. So hopefully, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give success to all those who sincerely serve the message of Fatima Zahra, salamullah ta'ala alayha. And if I have said any mistakes or anything of that sort, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all. And hopefully, inshallah, we are granted the ziyarah and shafa'ah of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, salamullah ta'ala alayh, in this world, and hopefully the shafa'ah of his mother as well in the next, salamullah ta'ala alayha. Wal istijabat al-du'a wa daf' al-bala' nahdih li jami' al-hadirin wa amwatihim wal مجاهدين في هذا المجلس المبارك إن شاء الله نهدي لهم جميعا ثواب سورة المباركة الفاتحة مسبوقة بالصلاة على محمد وآل محمد.